As the engines fire tonight, as brave men face the test of speed, we remember a fallen friend. We race tonight in memory of Rich Vogler.
Saturday Night Thunder is open.
For more than 40 years, these high banks have called out to the heroes of open wheel racing. Foyt, Jones, Sachs, O'Connor, Andretti, Carter, and Vogler. They've all come here and won here at Salem, Indiana. Tonight, Robbie Stanley seeks his third win of the season. Consistency has given him the lead in USAC Sprint Car Championship. Another young hero, Eric Gordon, is in hot pursuit. With his recent win in Michigan, Eric is just 42 points out of the lead. But Steve Butler has broken his bad luck string. Champion four of the last 5 years, Butler is closing fast. They have big hearts and a whole lot of horsepower, brave souls and the will to win. They are the local heroes, and they live for Saturday night. ESPN, the world leader in motorsports coverage, presents Speed World. Welcome to an anniversary celebration, the 40th year of racing at Salem Speedway, Salem, Indiana, the Joe James Pat O'Connor Memorial for the United States Auto Club Sprint Cars. Crowd gathered, and if you had one word to describe the weather for tonight, that weather would be absolutely perfect. 75 degrees, a nice breeze to keep things comfortable, humidity and chance of rain, barely worth talking about. Hello, everyone. I'm Dave Despain. Welcome to Salem Speedway. We're on the move this Saturday Night Thunder episode, a couple of hours south of our summer home in Indianapolis, about 40 miles north of Louisville, Kentucky, at a racetrack that has a tremendous history for United States Auto Club cars. The list of winners, literally a who's who. I know that's a cliche, but in this case, it is certainly true. If you had one word to describe the action at this place, it would be wild. But the focal point tonight really is the battle for the USAC Sprint Car Championship. Let's take a look at the points, first of all. There's Robbie Stanley with a couple of victories and the point lead, but not by much, over Eric Gordon, and the man really on the move, as we mentioned at the top of the show, is Butler, and he's fast qualifier tonight. Greg Staub and Brad Marvel rounding out the top five. Let's go ahead and take a look at the second five in the standings. Jeff Bloom with a lot of experience on this racetrack. Saldana, of course, a second-generation racer. Adams, Rose, and Thomas rounding out the top ten. How did the top three get there? Consistency. Look at the top ten finishes. 11 for Robbie Stanley and 10 for Eric Gordon. Butler with only seven. A lot of trouble early in the season, but definitely on the comeback and on the move. And again, fast qualifier tonight, perhaps the man to beat. We'll find out more about that as we go topside to the guys who will call the action tonight. Larry Rice standing by with Gary Lee. Guys, tell me about this place.
Thanks, Dave. Hi, everybody. The veterans call these the hills, the high banks of Winchester and Salem. Mr. Rice, you've driven both, and there are some differences.
Well, certainly there's some differences. This racetrack is bigger. It's officially 5.555 miles around this racetrack. The straightaways are longer, the corners are sharper. I think it makes it tougher to get off the corners here. I like this racetrack better than Winchester. A lot of guys don't, but no matter whether you do or not, it's exciting every second you're in that seat.
Robbie Stanley leading the points, surprisingly a two-time victor at Winchester. He's never raced here before.
He had never raced at Winchester either, and he won there. He says he's going to watch Steve Butler. He likes the way Steve Butler runs the banks. He's going to kind of study him here tonight. But either way, I think the high speed, high corner speed of the wing sprint cars really helped him know the high speeds of the banks, and I think that's one reason he's so fast on the banks.
And one driver is going to night school this evening. Young Tony Stewart, a grad of TQ Midgets on dirt, is making his sprint car debut. I can think of other tracks to debut on.
I tell you, it's kind of like putting him in the ring with Mike Tyson for his first professional boxing match. You know, it's a tough place. His whole thing tonight is to study the racetrack, study the race cars, run straight, and stay out of trouble. That's his goal, and I think he's good enough to do that.
We have four heat races. We have the lineup for heat race number one. Once again, Dave Despain.
Field forming up for the first of the heat races with Joey Saldana, number 88S, on the inside on the pole. Brad Marvel lining up outside row one. Top four will transfer as Dave Dernwald and Greg Staub take their positions in row two. Jim Mahoney and Jim Keeker will comprise row three. And starting out back for the first of four qualifiers, Steve Butler, co-fast qualifier tonight, along with Chet Phillip. We're ready to go. We'll take four heat races, transfer four out of each at Saturday Night Thunder, and that means it's time for the Gary and Larry Show. Have at it, guys.
Thanks, Dave. And once again, we reiterate, this field is inverted. The fastest qualifiers in the rear as we ride along with Jim Keeker in the Glenn Nibel-built car, the Carquest Cage Cam. And look at this. Into 33-degree banking, into turn three, into turn four. We're going to take the green flag. Well, they had, though, not a very good start, Larry.
Well, we had a couple guys touch coming off the corner there, and everybody had to get out of the throttle because it was very, very exciting. Everybody wanted to not get in trouble when those two guys touched. The yellow light's on. You can see it down there at the end of the straightaway. But when those two cars came together coming off the corner, everybody in back had to get out of the throttle. They couldn't take a chance that they were going to get in worse trouble than they were already in.
For those of you that have been with us every week, please bear with us, but again, explain why we got a green than the yellow.
Well, because they feel it's safer to go ahead and let them get a start, go down the back straightaway, and then they've got that big, long back straightaway to pull out of the throttle easily, carry their speed, slow up very slowly, so that nobody jams on the brakes, jumps over a wheel, and gets hurt. So they do that for safety reasons.
Well, we have a car already in the pit area as we take a look from the in car on the replay. Now watch these two get together. That is Dave Dernwald down on the inside, and he is the driver in that red number four. He is the driver that's in the pit area right now, so there may be a problem.
Yeah, he got hit. Mahoney ran into the back of Dernwald, so he had a flat tire. He pulled in, had to change the flat tire. Once you get together like that, the white car pulled down, hit Dernwald, he backed out of the throttle to stay out of trouble, and he got hit in the back. So it was just a chain reaction. Very bad chain reaction.
And here's a look at the four-time USAC Sprint Car Champion, the white 69 car of Steve Butler. He was the fastest qualifier here, and as we indicated earlier, he's had some mechanical problems. He has been fast every time out in qualifying. He's had some mechanical problems. He well could take a fifth title this season.
Well, he certainly could. He's had a lot of bad luck. He was leading the race up at Martin, Michigan when he got crashed. So it's just luck is a big, big factor in automobile racing. I don't care how good you are. If you're not lucky, you're not going to win championships and win races. But if you're there every time in the hunt, which he is, then you're going to win your share.
Once again, we ride with Jim Keeker. This is the Glenn Nibel-built car that's about 13 years old, perhaps one of the most successful sprint cars still in active competition. Dave Dernwald has changed the flat tire. He is on the backstretch trying to catch up to the field. It is dusk here in southern Indiana, and perhaps as we get a shot going down the backstretch, you can glance off to the right and see that beautiful nine-hole golf course. We should have brought the sticks down this afternoon.
We should have done that, but we didn't get here in time, so we had to.
You play golf?
Not very well.
Good.
Not
Let's play golf next weekend.
Dave Dernwald is going to have to start in the back of this heat race. It was very bad luck for him. Uh-oh, looks like he's going to try to move up. They're not going to let him do that, I don't think, because once you stop, you've got to go to the back of the field, and I think they'll make him start in the back of this race.
Well, let's see if we get an indication from starter Wally Shear as they come by as we ride with Keeker again as they roll into turn four. Well, the green flag flies, so they're going to let... Yeah, Dernwald went to the back of the pack on that one.
Boy, Butler moved right up in front of Keeker. Keeker had to get out of the throttle just a little bit to stay out of trouble. This is a great shot. Look at this shot down here. Everybody tries to get in line. It's a lot easier. Look, boy, that was a good pass for the lead that Jim Mahoney just made. Look at these cars moving around, though. Brad Marvel moving around a lot in that eight car right in front of Keeker. Keeker's trying to get around him, but he doesn't want to make a very quick move that's going to get him in trouble. Butler can't quite get around him down on the inside.
Well, Butler remains on the inside going into three. They roll into turn four, and a big lead right now for Mahoney in that black and white number four, Joey Saldana, who does not have a whole lot of pavement experience now, running in second position and holding off Greg Staub.
He's doing a great job. He does not even like the pavement. He'll be the first to tell you. He doesn't have enough experience to know what to expect and to really get a good feel of it. Boy, look at that. Look at this. Butler slides up across Keeker. Keeker went down low to try to get around him, but he just didn't have the momentum. Nobody can get around Brad Marvel. He's running a very good race in that Ward's apparel car, but he's looks like he's got him this time. Right in front of him, he slide right up in front of him, take the racetrack away.
Keeker tries the inside too as they come off turn four. He keeps that Nibel-built V6 on the inside, but once again, only the first four transfer.
Yes, here he is. He's down on the inside. Looks like he's got him now. He's going to move right up in front of him. Once you get even with him and can just get that car length to get back up in the groove, it really is much easier for that guy.
Battle for second position now as we take a look at Joey Saladini in that yellow number 88. Now there's a good battle for third as Butler looks to the inside of Greg Stobbs. Stobbs on the high side, the white 44. Butler to the inside, and here comes that yellow number 20.
You see how much horsepower they kill when they get way up on the racetrack and try to diamond down off like he does there. Tries to get a big, long straightaway run on him, get in under him, but he can't quite get far enough to get up in front of him. Oh, here he's going to go. He's going to get in front of him now. When that back end just slid just that little bit on Greg Stobbs' car, it gave Butler the opportunity to go ahead and get around him.
Wally Shear has the white flag out for your leader as Mahoney goes by in the lead. Now, here is the battle for the fourth and final transfer position. This is Keeker. He makes a move to the high side coming off the second corner.
Great race. I got to tell you, Joey Saldana running in second in this race. I think this is the first pavement race he's ever run that he's felt comfortable in because he really looks like he knows what he's doing. He finishes second. Butler finishes third, and Keeker had to settle for fifth spot. Tough, tough heat race.
You think that in the infield someplace there's a happy Joe Saldana, Joey's dad?
Very, very happy. They've had an awful lot of bad luck. Joey's crashed that car a couple times. He said it never felt good to him, but obviously it feels a lot better tonight, so I'm happy for them and the crew because they've worked real hard on that pavement car, I know.
There's the winner in the Staff Racing Components entry, and there is Steve Staff walking alongside the car. A good crowd on hand for just a wonderful evening for motorsports competition. Your first four, they will transfer. Jim Mahoney, Joey Saldana, Steve Butler, and Greg Staub. So once again, the first of four heat races, and by inverting them, it makes it very exciting, but a great ride for Joey Saldana, but we'll have an exciting semi too.
Saturday Night Thunder is brought to you by Bud Light. Everything else is just a light. By Suzuki, your Suzuki dealer has the ride you've been waiting for and the financing to get it. And by Quaker State, the big Q is one tough motor oil. We'll be back with all the Salem action right after this.
Back at Salem, Indiana, Pat O'Connor, remembered fondly by the Hoosiers as we race tonight in the event that carries Pat O'Connor's name. And the first of our qualifying heat races is in the record book. And Jim Mahoney has come home the winner over Joey Saldana, Steve Butler, and Greg Staub, rounding out the transfer positions. Jim's run four times this year, and he's got three top 10 finishes, including a second at Indianapolis Raceway Park. Was that heat race the cakewalk that it looked like?
No, it was pretty hard. It was a brand new car. We were trying to figure out the spring race with the car. Steve Staub did a heck of a job putting it together. Everybody at Staff's organization worked real hard to get the car together. I'm just happy I can be here. We worked hard all summer long trying to make things go, and hopefully with a little bit more running we can really make it happen.
When you come to a place like this with a brand new race car, what's the focus? What are you trying to get sorted out for the heat race and for the main event?
We're trying to see what the car does to adjustments. We made a few adjustments in qualifications, and it screwed us up. We went slower than what we were running. So we went back to the original setup and stuff like that, and it just made a difference, world of difference in the heat race and stuff. You know, I like to thank Simpson, Hoosier Tires, Mike Guglielmucci at Fastlane. I want to wish his little boy a happy first birthday coming up tomorrow. And this is everything on ESPN. This is a nice family deal you guys put on. Really appreciate it a lot.
Hey, it's pretty good money tonight. You could buy a heck of a birthday present with the first place first. He's headed for the main event, and we'll be back with more from Salem. Jim Mahoney wins heat race number one. We'll be ready for heat number two right after this.
Now we are back for the Loctite USAC Sprint Cars from the Salem Speedway in Southern Indiana. We are ready now for heat race number two. Jim Mahoney won the first one. We'll have four heat races, the semi and the 30-lap main event. A good crowd on hand, both in the infield, also up here in the grandstand. I can think of probably not a better night we've had for racing, Larry Rice, than the one we have this evening.
Oh, it's beautiful tonight. This is a beautiful setting down here in Southern Indiana. We like to come down here, and it's always good racing, too.
We heard Jim Mahoney talk about the spring rates and trying to adjust that car. Obviously, you've been involved in that over the years.
Well, it's trying to choose the correct torsion bar or springs depending on what kind of car you have. Jim Mahoney happens to be running a torsion bar car, so he has to choose the correct torsion bar that lets the race car go up and down and move correctly can't be too hard. If it's too hard, the back end wants to slide around. If it's too stiff on the right rear, or if it's too soft on the right rear, it wants to lean way over on the right rear. So you have to get those spring rates on all four corners matched up correctly. And when you do, the race car is very, very fast. We saw some of the cars last week at Raceway Park lifting the left front up, jumping up and down. The spring rates were not correct in those, or all four tires would stay on the ground and run flat around the racetrack.
In weeks past, we've talked a lot about, in the midget series, Stan Fox practicing a lot. That's a key, getting that testing session.
I'm sorry, Gary, what is that?
We talked about Stan Fox's crew testing a lot, but when you're trying to set your spring rates, that's important for testing.
It is, exactly. Here we see a car. That car, that 65 car on the outside, Gary, is a coil spring car. That car was built in about 1965. It's 25 or 27 years old. It's a real old race car. We're going to have a little feature on some old race cars later, but this race car really goes quick for as old as it is, and it's Bruce Roby does a good job in that car.
That's the Clarence Miller car. That's about, 25 or 30 years old. Once again, ready for heat race number two. In the front row, Bruce Field in number 85, and Bruce Roby outside in 65. In the second row, we have Bill Rose, the 3RD car, and there's Bob Ciccone out of Prospect Park, Pennsylvania, in the red 59. The third row, Eric Gordon in number 6, Chet Phillip in number 19, and rounding out the field in number 17, Roger Anderson. We actually had a tie for fast qualifier this evening with the Chet Phillip in 19 and Steve Butler, but Butler was the first to turn the time.
You know, we've had a lot of surprises tonight. Chet Phillip has run the banks. He's run well. He's run at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. He's run well there, but he really hadn't been as fast at Winchester as he was here tonight. Eric Gordon, he's always very, very quick. He's usually in the top two or three. He's fast here tonight, but Chet Phillip beat him. He's
Gordon is sixth fast, and we invert the fastest six qualifiers if they make it to the feature, which means that Gordon would start from the pole position.
Well, believe me, starting up front is such an advantage on this racetrack. It's very fast. The faster it is, the tougher it is to get around the car. When you see cars pass somebody at this racetrack, you know they've got their act together, because it's a very tough thing to do.
Two veterans up in the front row, Bruce Field in 85 and Bruce Roby in 65. They should get the green this time by as they pick up the throttle. Gordon immediately looks to the inside. We have a green flag from Wally Shear and that Clarence Miller special out in front, number 65, Roby. But here comes Ciccone on the high side in the red 59. He gets a good start.
Oh, he sure did. Look at this. Bruce Roby got way out in the front. He wiggled a little bit on the very start, but he got back out front. Look at Ciccone. He was high. Now he went low, went right around Bruce Field. Great job. But look at Chet Phillip. He's up in the third spot already. Very quick. He got up there very, very fast.
Well, Ciccone is driving the car designed and built by Dan Drinan, who we've seen in midget competition with a radical front suspension, and a problem already for Bruce Field.
Yeah, Bruce Field's obviously got a big problem. He's pulled down. Look how low on the racetrack Bruce Roby's running out front. I think eventually that's going to cost him the lead in the race. If Ciccone figures out how to get around him on the outside, he's going to zip by him, because that's a little bit lower than the really, really fast guys want to run. But nobody seems to be able to want to go on the outside right now. They don't feel comfortable way on the outside of him, so they're trying to get high, diamond back out underneath him and get around him down the straightaway.
Here's the battle for the fourth and final transfer spot. That's the black number 6. That's the guy who's second in points. That is Gordon. Now we go back to the front of the pack. Fifth now is Bill Rose, and now Gordon closes in on the number 19, the white 19 of Chet Phillip, and Phillip pulls to the inside of Ciccone.
They almost get together. Oh, you can see that coming all the way, coming off that corner. You can see it's going to be real, real quick. Ciccone had to get out of the throttle, and when he did, he lost that spot. I'm going to see if Chet Phillip now feels brave enough to go on the outside. Yes, he is. He's going to try it. He's going to go right around him on the outside. If he can do it, yep, that's the place to do it, if you're brave enough. But believe me, that is a hard stopper to go around a guy on this racetrack on the outside.
Do you think Roby was holding them up, and now they're going to try the high side, and once they get by, they'll pull away from him?
Exactly. Roby is holding them up. I mean, he's running plenty fast, but they are running faster, and he's just kind of holding them up. But Ciccone doesn't feel comfortable. Oh, again, that looks close coming off of there.
You know, the guys running 1, 2, and 3, Ciccone, Roby, and Field have all three driven that blue number 65 over the years.
Yes, that's a good car. In 25 years, believe me, you've got a lot of guys up here. I drove that race car one time at Raceway Park, and believe me, it handled pretty doggone good.
This is the battle for the third spot now as Gordon looks to the inside of Bob Ciccone. Gordon in that black number 6 slides just a bit, loses the rear end, has to back out of the throttle. And there's the checkered flag.
Chet Phillip did a great job. He won that race. Roby did a fantastic job running second. Nobody except Chet Phillip was brave enough to use the high road. The high road was the way around him, and it just seemed like Saccone didn't feel comfortable enough up there, and you have to feel comfortable to run around a guy on the outside.
That's the key I was going to make, and I'm glad you said that. You talk about being brave. It's not just being brave. You have to feel comfortable with that race car.
The other word there is trust. You have to trust the guy that you're going around on the outside. If you don't trust him, if you're not sure what he's going to do, you cannot make that move on the outside like Chet Phillip did. Obviously, he trusted Bruce Roby, and his trust paid off.
Well, by virtue of his victory, he will transfer on into our main event. We have two more heat races coming up, then the one semi, and of course, we'll cap off our evening of racing with a 30-lap feature from the rolling hillsides of southern Indiana. We're at Salem on Saturday Night Thunder. Come back and join us. As we're back live at the Salem Speedway in southern Indiana, we look at Bob Saccone's number 59, a family reunion. Bob Saccone's dad on the right there, Lou Saccone, and we also have Dan Drinan there in the yellow Earl's T-shirt. He built that one. And, of course, we have a very special group of young men here this evening, and they're serving as honorary crew members for a number of the drivers. We had a chance to check in with Dave Despain earlier on that.
I'd like to take the opportunity to welcome a very special race team to Salem here tonight. Gene Lee Gibson, Brad Marvel, and Bob Saccone are members of a new organization called Racers Who Care. And what they are doing is taking their program to the tracks and providing disadvantaged young people and young adults with the opportunity to get close to the racing scene. Tonight's group are here from the Blue River Developmental Services Program, and they're no strangers to Salem. In fact, they come here and clean up the track every week after the races are over, but this is their first opportunity to actually see the races. And Bob, I'm wondering what the message is that you carry to the people who take part in this program.
The message of Racers Who Care, Dave, is basically give them a chance. We feel that by providing a role model to people that are not as fortunate as us that had a complete family, we give them a role model to strive for, to give them goals. Also, we like to stress that education is always useful, and it gives people a chance to help themselves. And through this program, really self-help is the key issue.
All three of these guys have been in the program from the beginning, and a lot more drivers are getting involved. These guys have their first opportunity tonight to be on television. Y'all set? One, two, three. Hi, Mom.
Hi, Mom.
All right. If inspiration counts for anything, look for these three guys to get to the front tonight. They got a great pit crew.
Mom. Well, as we take a look at Brad Marvel's mount, that is the Larry Fritz sprint car, and we'll see him in more competition yet this evening here at Salem. Well, we've had two heat races, and let's go down and talk to the winner of heat race number two, Dave.
All right, thank you very much, Gary. We've seen Chet Phillip in a lot of different race cars over the years. He's obviously very comfortable in the USAC Sprinter tonight. Tell me about heat race number two.
Well, the car is working super. My brother with ARS has got the thing handling good, and it's just, we didn't touch a thing since we unloaded. Just throw some tires on and go.
When you come out as a co-fast qualifier, that's got to give you a lot of confidence going into the heat race.
Yeah, the car is super. Yeah, that's the best we've qualified certainly all year. A couple weeks ago, we were sixth or fifth, but so we're getting there.
Let me ask you about the pass for the lead. You followed and followed and followed it. The obvious, the only way around was going to be the high line. Were you nervous about getting up there that close to the fence?
Well, yeah, but Bruce was starting to get a little loose and kept pulling it down. And I didn't think he'd move up on me, and he didn't. He gave me room.
Now, Larry Rice said it well. Trust is the key issue. Chet Phillips wins the heat race as we prepare for heat race number three. We'll be back with more live from Salem Speedway right after this.
USAC, the most diversified sanctioning body in auto racing, sanctions the Indianapolis 500-mile race for the 36th consecutive year in 1991 as part of a racing schedule involving over 150 exciting events. Having already awarded over $100 million in total prizes, USAC is bigger and better than ever. Become a part of the excitement. Write for more information about membership in the United States Auto Club. Don't miss another exciting lap. Be there when the next green flag waves.
Check out the upcoming USAC action next Saturday night, the National Sprint Series, Claremont, Indiana. That's Indianapolis Raceway Park, and that sounds like Saturday Night Thunder to me. Morrow Mile High Classic coming up on July 26th, 27th out in Denver, Colorado. So be sure and check it out when the USAC cars are in your neck of the woods. Let's go back topside for more of the Gary and Larry Show.
And speaking of that Mile High Classic, a former winner of that one seated next to me, Larry Rice. You won it about three or four times, didn't you?
Yes, I did, and I love the Mile High Classic. I love the Morrow family. They've
You've done a great job out there. We always have a lot of fun out there.
Row one for heat race number three, Mike Blake and Bob Seelman. In the second row on the inside, Donnie Adams, outside young Rick Howerton in the team car, the one we saw earlier with Gordon in. Then Robbie Stanley leading the point standings, number seven, Chip Thomas, and then Brian Whited. We'll round out the field in car number 45.
Chip Thomas is a big, big surprise. Here we're in the in-car camera. Stanley also has the in-car camera.
He should look at this billboard. We talk about all the commercialism.
They've even got him on the hood, facing backwards. They don't care if the people in the grandstands.
These guys catch on in a hurry, don't they?
But it's great. It's great. They deserve all the publicity. These guys put a lot of money into automobile racing. They deserve to get a little publicity on this thing once in a while. It should be a great start if they give us a shot from the end car.
All right, we ride with Robbie Stanley, who's won twice in the high banks of Winchester. We're at Salem on the high banks this evening.
Boy, look at this. Look how those cars move around. I mean, he's following those guys. He's trying to fight, figure out where to go.
That was Donnie Adams. Boy, he had some problems.
When Donnie Adams got sideways, you saw immediately he tried to get out from behind him. He didn't care what happened to him. He wanted to get away from him.
Now he pulls up behind Mike Blake in that orange 81, trying the high side. Now he tucks in behind Donnie Adams. He's running in fifth position. Remember, only the first four transfer.
Yeah, Donnie Adams is down and out. Boy, he got close to Mike Blake just then. Mike Blake moved up and got out of his way. That was very, very, very close, I'll tell you.
Look at that gap, though, to the front of the pack. There's your look at third and fourth. But way up in front is that black number six. He's out in front, and that would be Rick Howerton.
Donnie Adams has got some real problems with that race car. He's pushing, and it's loose. And he doesn't know which way it's going to go. Looks like he gets right in the middle of the corner, and the thing's car's pushing. That's pushing. See, it's pushing real bad. See how far those wheels are turning the left? And when he does that, Robbie Stanley went zip right under it.
You got a J&J sandwich between a pair of beasts right now. Stanley rides in third position, looks to the inside of Bob Seelman. Seelman, that red number 74.
We were talking about spring race. Watch Bob Seelman. Watch that car bottom out as it goes through here and throw the sparks. See that right there? The car is too low. It doesn't have a stiff enough spring. That's the reason it's bottoming out. And when it does that, it upsets the race car. Stanley's just going to zip right on around him on the outside.
So Stanley moves to second. Seelman drops to third. Donnie Adams rides in fourth. Now remember, the first four transfer. You mentioned Chip Thomas, a surprise in qualifying. Qualified very well. He was third fast, but he's having some trouble transferring right here.
Well, it's tough to pass people.
Black flag. The black flag is being displayed. Excuse me, the black flag is being displayed for number 45, Whited.
Okay, this is Howerton who was leading the race. He's run away with it. He's doing a great job. And here's the battle for fourth. As we see Seelman, we see Donnie Adams right behind him. Adams is not working all that well either. And I think Chip Thomas, who's back there in fifth and trying to transfer, he just doesn't know quite where to go. He's a little hesitant as to try to go around one of those guys on the inside or the outside, because Donnie Adams moves up, he moves down, trying to find a place to go around Seelman.
The checkered flag will be displayed this time for... look at this battle for the lead. It is Rick Howerton. I tell you, once Robbie Stanley got clear of traffic, boy, he chased down Howerton and almost got a victory. We went over to Terre Haute, Indiana, to the action track last Sunday. He did the same thing in the semi and had some trouble getting through traffic. Once he did, he was gone.
That kid is some kind of race car driver. He's awfully, awfully brave. He scares me sometimes, but he really handles that race car well. He got around him. He caught Howerton. He didn't care if it was the last lap. He was going to go for it, and he almost pulled it off.
Well, Howerton takes the victory. He has to be very happy because he's had some terrible luck in midgets and sprints this season. From the tail end of last season through this season, he had, well, this is probably his best ride here on the high banks.
Right. That's the 6T car, they call it. That's Eric Gordon's other car. So he did a real great job in it.
Rick Howerton takes the victory over Robbie Stanley, Donnie Adams, and Bob Seelman. So those four will transfer to the main event. We still have one heat race to go, then the semi and the main event.
Yeah, it's tough in these heat races. It's tough to get through through the pack, as we see. Look at the fire out here.
Get the marshmallows out. It's not quite cold enough for a marshmallow campfire.
No, I don't think it's quite that cool.
Look at the heat waves off that thing.
Cooler. It's cooler here than it has been. We've had a real heat wave, and it's a little cooler, but I don't think it's that cool.
Well, as we are at the Salem Speedway in southern Indiana for Saturday Night Thunder with the USAC Lot Packed Sprint Cars, and we have more racing coming your way, so we ask you to stay tuned because we have a heat race coming up.
Saturday Night Thunder at Salem, Indiana for the USAC Sprint Car Show. Tomorrow night, Sunday night baseball. Quick reminder, it'll be the Texas Rangers versus the hottest team in baseball, the Toronto Blue Jays. I hear Nolan Ryan's going to be pitching for that one. Check it out at 8 o'clock Eastern time tomorrow night here on ESPN. A few years ago, I was doing a story about a motorcycle racer by the name of Bubba Schobert. Traveled the whole weekend, and a member of the pit crew was this kid named Howerton, who's telling me someday I'm going to be a great race car driver. Rick, 2 weeks in a row, you make a heat race victory and make it on TV. Congratulations. It's nice to see you finally getting to the front here.
Thanks, Dave. I was trying to shake that monkey off my back like you were talking about last weekend. And the Molds Unlimited car is running real good. It's a little on the loose side. We'll tighten her up for the feature and start back in the fifth row and see if we can't make it to the front.
Eric Gordon's been over here having all kinds of chit-chat with you. What's going on here? What's the story on this T car here? We see the T cars at the Speedway. What's the deal?
Well, that's his car from last year he ran, and I figured just for a little humor, I'd put a T at the end of the six for his backup car today.
What do you think the prospects are for the main event?
Oh, if we can get the car tightened up just a little bit, I look for good things to happen, running up in the top two, three.
Man says he's a little bit loose, but they'll fix her in time for the feature. We got heat race number four coming up, and there's Steve Butler hoping to continue his run toward the top of the standings. We'll be right back.
Ready for heat race number four. Here is your starting lineup. In the front row, number 27M, Jamie Matthews, alongside the green number 99 of Brad Armstrong. In the second row, we have Tony Stewart, the youngster making his debut, outside Gene Lee Gibson, the veteran from Ohio. In the third row, Brandy Sweet. In 2X, Jeff Bloom, the pavement specialist from Michigan, and outside 67. And Charlie Workman in number 45, alone in row four. Well, you think the heart is beating just a little faster inside the cockpit of number 25?
I think so. I think Tony right now is wondering what this is all about. And the car on the outside of him has a special little meaning, too, with Gene Lee Gibson, that car, Paul Leffler's. Tony Stewart, though, is doing a great job here. I think he's more nervous now than he's probably ever been, because I don't think he's ever run this fast in his life, and it's got to be exciting for him.
And Gene Lee Gibson outside, 5 USAC sprint wins during a career, but he is driving a car, brand new car, designed and built by Paul Leffler. There is a guy that built the chassis to have back in the mid-70s.
Exactly. He won a lot of races on the banks with those race cars. He knows how to build them, and I think Gene Lee's looking for big things tonight.
Well, Wally Shear has the green flag. He turns them loose, and Brad Armstrong out in front, the green beast number 99. But look at Gene Lee Gibson, the Leffler chassis down to the inside. He takes second position going into three.
He sure did. Oh, look, Tony Stewart.
Three abreast.
Tony Stewart had the thoughts of going underneath Jimmy Matthews, but he couldn't quite pull it off. He had to back off. But look at that Alan Knott car up there with Gene Lee Gibson up front. He's running very well in a brand new race car.
There's the battle for the lead. There is the number 99. And right behind the white number 9, that is the battle for the lead as Gene Lee Gibson looks to the inside of Brad Armstrong.
But that is the 67 car is Jeff Bloom. He's running very, very fast, and that 67 car catching him real quick, too.
Well, Jeff Bloom, of course, has just a ton of experience on pavement. He is recognized for his expertise on pavement, and he could be a factor here this evening.
Oh, certainly. He's a factor every time he goes on the pavement. He knows the pavement racetracks. He's run them his whole life. He loves the pavement. But I tell you what, Gene Lee Gibson out in front of that Leffler car is going to be tough to beat in this race.
Look how low the last corner, one and two, look how low that he was as we go back in the pack just a bit. There's Randy Sweet, the stock car veteran, in car number two, making only a second appearance in a sprint car.
And believe me, this is going to be an education for him, too. But look at this, Jeff Bloom. He tried real hard coming off of two, but he got a little sideways when he got down under Armstrong there and just could not quite pull it off. That 67 car is going fast, but not quite fast enough to get around Brad Armstrong right.
That's the battle for second, but right now Gene Lee Gibson has the measure coming off the second corner and down the back stretch as we take a tight look there at the Brad Armstrong car. As we look back in the pack, once again we talked about Randy Sweet in the black number two pulling up behind Jimmy Matthews, only his second time in a sprint car.
Jimmy Matthews, it must be having trouble. He's running real low on the racetrack, but Randy Sweet right now doesn't feel comfortable enough to go around the outside of him. He's having a lot of trouble, and he's just run. Oh, he got in trouble right there.
And look at Tony Stewart go by. That's Charlie Workman down on the inside. Stewart moves up a position.
Young Tony Stewart did a great job right there, missing an accident or not causing
a flag. He's going for a transfer. corner position.
Boy, I'll tell you what, he doesn't look like it's his first time. I thought he was going to poke him right in on the outside of him, but he didn't do it.
Front of the pack, checkered flag, Gene Lee Gibson, second place. We'll go to Brad, but here's this battle for third. Brad Armstrong takes second. Here's the battle for third. Stewart gets a little loose. What a great education. I'm impressed. He is showing maturity for a youngster.
He did a very good job. I tell you, it's a tough place to come and learn. I think he learned well, and he did exactly what we said. He kept the race car straight. He learned what was going on out there. He learned what the racing is all about on a high-speed racetrack, and he did a good job.
Gene Lee Gibson takes the victory, and I am curious, with a brand new race car, that's the first new sprint car I have seen without down tubes, that tube that goes from the top of the cage down to the front of the car.
Have you ever seen Paul Leffler do anything like anybody else?
I guess not.
He's not going to. He's going to build them Paul Leffler style, and that is Paul Leffler style and victory.
You know what they say about Paul Leffler as we look at the top four? If you haven't been fired, you've never driven for Paul Leffler.
Exactly.
Is that right?
That's exactly
right.
I'm
not stretching the truth.
No, no. He fired a lot of good race car drivers, and he fired a lot of bad race car drivers.
Well, we took a look there at the top four. And once again, now let's watch. This is Randy Sweet in the black number two.
He tried to pinch it down real low coming off there. The back end got loose, and look, as soon as the back end got loose, he corrected. Then the front end took off on him, and he just had to get out of the throttle to keep out of the fence. And he did a good job just staying out of the fence at that point, because once the back end slid out, the front end let loose, he was heading straight for the fence. He got out of the throttle.
Tony Stewart did a good job, too, because he crossed right over the front bumper as we take a look at the Allen Knott Honda entry out of Lima, Ohio. The driver and the victor of that heat race, Gene Lee Gibson. So we'll come back to the Salem Speedway and talk with the winner of heat race number four.
We're back live at Saturday Night Thunder action, Salem Speedway, Salem, Indiana, for the Loctite Sprint Car Series, and the winner of heat race number four, Gene Lee Gibson. Give you a look at this brand new Paul Leffler creation here, and then get an opportunity to talk to the guy who has driven it straight into victory lane in its first appearance. Congratulations, Gene Lee. Must be a pretty good ride.
Yeah, we got a few more bugs to get worked out, but I think we're going to be right there at the end. I wish we could have got a little better qualifying time, but we were still trying to sort the car out with some bugs, and we broke a shock mount off, and we're getting I say we don't have any base to work from, so we're kind of going from square one.
For a zero starting point, this is pretty good progress to put the thing out front in its very first ride.
Well, the guy that built the car, Paul Leffler, he gave us a base to set up, and Paul builds a real good car. And then Dick Johnson, you know, he's the chief mechanic, and you know, he knows a lot about cars, and we're going from there. And we're just taking a few steps at a time. We made a bunch of changes for that heat race. After qualifying, we decided to do something different, and we really made some changes. We took about 2 inches of stagger out of it. It was pinning right front big time, and fixed the shock mount that broke off. I think we're getting there. I guess we run some times at 16.4s in the heat, and that's about quicker than anybody ran all day so far in the heats.
Let's talk about the feature now. Who are going to be the guys to beat, and do you have the potential here to win the thing tonight?
Well, all of them in front of me, because of the bad qualifying spot. I'm going to have to start 12th, so I've got my work cut out for me, but I could use a caution about probably every 6 or 7 laps, keep the pack close to me.
I don't know if we'll get that organized or not, but we'll sure wish you good luck tonight.
Okay, thank you.
That's Gene Lee Gibson, the winner of heat race number four. We'll be back to update some of the rest of the racing news right after we take this time out. Saturday Night Thunder coming to you from Salem, Indiana. We'll be right back.
Back in Salem, Indiana for live coverage of the 32nd running of the Joe James Pat O'Connor Memorial Race as we take a look at the crew working on Robbie Stanley's number 7. There's Robbie's dad, Ron Stanley, there walking over by the right side of the race car.
Yeah, they work on this race car all week long. This is their whole life. That whole family is very, very involved in that race car, and I think that's one reason they've been so successful. They take it very seriously. I can remember going to Robbie Stanley's high school when he's in high school, and I said, you know, racing is a lot of fun, but don't ever try to make a living at it. You can't do it. Here he comes out here, he wins all these races, and he's been making a living at it for the last couple of years.
You say it's the whole family operation. It truly is. They are totally devoted to racing.
Oh, most certainly they are. They literally do work on that race car day and night at their shop.
Well, let's check in now with Dave and other news of motorsports.
Hi, thank you very much, Gary. One of my favorite parts of Saturday Night Thunder, checking out the rest of the racing world. Saturday night's just a warm-up.
off. We've got a monster day of motorsports coverage tomorrow coming up on ESPN. Let's take a quick rundown through the lineup here. We'll show you the Grand Prix of Britain from Silverstone, as they call it over there, bright and early tomorrow morning, 8:50 a.m. Eastern time. We'll be starting time. And how about it, guys? Got a grid? There you go. Nigel Mansell said this week, A, he will not retire from Formula One. He'll start negotiations with Williams later this week. That dispels another rumor that he might come to America and race kart, or perhaps even get a USAC sprint car ride. Ayrton Senna will be outside row two, trying to gain that, or outside row one, rather, second qualifying spot, trying to regain that early season form. Patrese and Berger in the second row, Alain Prost qualifying fifth for the Formula One race. The SCCA Trans Am cars will be in Des Moines this weekend, and you'll see that tomorrow live, 12:30 p.m. Eastern time. And as we check out the, we got the folks from Des Moines right here. Hello, ESPN from Banker Racing in Des Moines, Iowa. Those folks are going to have to hustle to get home for the Trans Am race tomorrow afternoon. Maybe they'll just watch it on ESPN. Scott Sharp is your fast qualifier there and the point leader after that big shuffle last weekend that you saw earlier today here on ESPN. Jack Baldwin rounding out row one. Irv Herr and Bob Sobey with Darren Brasfield completing the top five in qualifying. And we've got the Indy cars for the first time on ESPN from the Marlboro Grand Prix at the Meadowlands. East Rutherford, New Jersey will be the scene of the action. That too is live coming up tomorrow afternoon at 2:30. Rick Mears on the pole there. How about that at 115 and a new track record for the guy that pretty decent road racer, Emerson Fittipaldi alongside. Andretti and Ray Hall in the second row. Mario will start from fifth starting spot tomorrow as the Indy cars have at it. We'll go ahead and run down through the rest of the top 10 for you. Unser Jr. is sixth. Harry Leyendijk and Scott Brayton, seventh and eighth. Scott Pruitt and Mike Groff round out the qualifying order. Here is Jim Kuecker at the controls of the number 20 car, the Jim Neifel car. We talked about the fact that there are, I'm sorry, the Glenn Neifel car. We talked about the fact that there are several of the sprint cars in this division that have got quite a fair bit of history. This is one of them. What do we say we go back and take a look at a little bit of the history of this car, find out how many of these pieces really are as old as Gary Lee claims they are. Gary?
To most motorsports fans, a legendary race car may be the one found in a museum, taken out once or twice a year for a slow exhibition lap. But as far as I'm concerned, we've had the luxury of watching a legendary race car in competition here on ESPN. We're in the Glenn Neifel race shops near Edinburgh, Indiana, about 30 miles south of Indianapolis, with the famous number 20 V6 Chevrolet sprint car. Now, this is an old race car by comparison. It was built back in 1978. It's a teenager, but listen to the track record. With Bob Fry here in the cockpit, this car has won the Little 500 four times, finished second three times. That's that grueling 500-lap sprint car race on the quarter-mile high bank track at Anderson, held every May. This car's also won the Copper Classic out in Phoenix four times, finished second three times. And of course, it still has a lot of races to run and win before it's ready for somebody's museum. Once again, the car builder, Glenn Neifel, built this machine back in 1978. He's had great success in midgets and sprint cars. And not long ago, Johnny Parsons drove your Silver Crown car to victory in the Pepsi-Cola 100 at Raceway Park. But there's something special about this race car. What makes it so special?
It's repeatability. It just, we worked with the race car long enough. Seems like you take it to the racetrack and you set it up like it was there before and it goes fast like it did before.
How much has this car been modified? Is this the same sprint car we saw last year, the year before last?
Last 3 years since we've been running so much more pavement with USAC, the car's basically been in the same configuration. Several years ago, we changed down through the years. I was changing something all the time in it just to try to get a little bit of an advantage.
Glenn, we've talked a lot about the weight advantage this car has, but realistically, just how much weight advantage does it have?
The car has right at 200 pounds. The sprint cars are allowed 200 pounds lighter for the six. The dirt car is 175 pounds, but we're running against 355s with the dirt car and 410 limit with the sprint cars.
But how does this compute to tire wear on that right rear?
Much easier on tires. Usually we can run one compound softer with this car, sometimes two, than the V8s can because of the balance and the lightweight.
When I mentioned that this is a teenager, 13 years old is really old by comparison to modern day race cars. Will this car still be competing in another 13 years?
That I'm not sure of. We'll keep the car running as long as it is competitive and a viable race car. But there's times you never know what's coming down the road in a situation like this, and there may be a day when it's not, but it's sure done its job to this point.
We talk a lot about chemistry in motorsports between an owner, a driver, but realistically, all the puzzle pieces fit together with this car: the chassis, the engine, the driver, and the owner.
Yeah, it was a really good relationship down through the years, even before with the V8, and since we went to the 6. Bob has always, he liked the car before, and it got even better, we felt like, with the six-cylinder, and it's one of them once-in-a-lifetime chemistries that exist between where everything works. The driver has to do his job, the mechanic and the car has to work, and it was just one of the, I feel like, a once-in-a-lifetime deal that lasted for 10 years.
This is a legendary race car, but it's not ready for mothballs or the museum quite yet.
All right, thank you very much, Gary Lee. Glenn Nibel's car is on the pole for the semifinal, looking for four more transfers to the main event. Let's set the lineup with Gary Lee and Larry Rice.
Well, actually, he ought to take the outside pole position because Chip Thomas has the pole. Jim Kuecker in the second position. In the second row, we have Randy Sweet and Bill Rose. The third row on the inside, Tony Stewart, the youngster, and Dave Dernwald outside. And then row four, Brad Marvel, Roger Anderson. And in row five, alone, Mike Blake and Brian Whited. So we are ready to go racing in the semi. This will be your last chance race. The first four will transfer. And right there, Jim Kuecker in the legendary number 20 out in front. He was the fifth fastest qualifier this evening, third quick. Chip Thomas rides in second position.
That's right. That race car is supposed to be a little bit down in horsepower, but you never know the way he zipped off that corner and right into the lead. They have maybe a short of horsepower slightly, but the weight more than makes up for it, and that's a fast, fast race car.
Black flag being displayed the last time by for, I think, Brian Whited. As we look out the back, that car back to second position, and that is...
That's a good ways back there, too, Gary. You can't hardly even...
Chip Thomas, you can't even see who's back there. You can't detect the cover of the race car.
Chip Thomas is doing a very good job. Here's the race for fourth position right here. Blake, Sweet, and Tony Stewart, our young guy. He's running fifth, and he's got a shot at making this feature race. His very first time on the banks.
Well, Randy Sweet, a veteran of stock car competition on the short tracks, making only his second start in a sprint car. And that time, Stewart goes high as Sweet went low, and they're working on Bill Rose.
The sprint car is much, much lighter than a stock car. They react much, much quicker. I think Randy's having a little bit of trouble getting used to the quickness of the reaction time and the lightness of the race car. You see, he makes those quick little moves, and it looks like maybe they're a little bit quick. See there, he got a wiggle. He jerked the wheel, and he got the race car wiggling when he turned it down. A stock car doesn't do that. They make a nice, smooth transition. That race car, when he jerks it like that, it doesn't make that smooth transition. He's got to do it himself.
Would you advocate slowing down the steering on a sprint car for a stock car veteran?
Oh, most certainly.
Everybody
has to slow the steering down. Everybody does.
This is the...
to make it... Uh-oh, Stewart's sideways down there. You can't get the right rear tire hot. He's running down there. That's something he's going to learn. But when he does that, he costs him a lot of spots, as we see right there.
He's starting to jump in there because there was a great battle for that fourth and final transfer positions. Once again, the last chance race. Black flag now being displayed for number 17, Roger Anderson, as your leader goes on by. A big gap between first and second as we continue to watch this battle for third, fourth, and fifth.
Yes, this is a very good race. Randy Sweet's trying very hard to get around Billy Rose. Stewart back there trying to get around him. Each one's trying to figure out just the right move to make, and none of them feel very comfortable making the move that they need to make.
Rose is sideways, but they can't take advantage of it.
Billy Rose, their heart stopped beating. That's why they couldn't take advantage of it. When he got sideways like that, they both lifted to stay out of trouble, and then he got back in the throttle and went on before they could take advantage of it.
Let's see what happens coming off turn four this time, as Sweet is right on the heels of Rose, and then it's Tony Stewart.
Once again, Sweet's trying to make that move down under. He might have it made this time. Nope, just cannot quite get up there far enough to drift out in front of him.
Yellow flag is out as we survey perhaps the reason for it. Roger Anderson had been black flagged. He is rolling slowly down the backstretch. And there is the reason for the yellow. Brad Marvel has stopped on the race course. Brad Marvel in the Larry Fritz number 8 car as we ride along with Jim Kuecker. And there is a look at the pretty red, white, and blue entry, and Marvel in the cockpit having a good ride this season.
Brad had a tough time tonight. He didn't get one single hot lap in that race car. The first lap he had was when he qualified. He went out, ran very good in his heat race, just missed the race by one spot, and it's a big, big trouble.
Yeah, he stopped over there between 3 and 4 down on the inside of this 33-degree banking as we come to you with the 32nd running of the Joe James Paddle Cutter Memorial, a race that was won in 1982 by Mr. Rice at the Terre Haute Action Track in Terre Haute, Indiana.
Yes, we did do that on the dirt. We could never pull it off down here. I'll tell you who was the real king of this place was Poncho Carter.
Yeah, Poncho had this place figured out. As we look back to Chip Thomas, who is riding in second position, but all throughout this race, we have enjoyed this battle for the third and fourth position. 9 laps now complete.
We have 9. We have 6 laps to go. Is it 12 laps? 3 laps to go, right?
3 laps to go as we take a look at a little Brad, help from my friends, and Brad Marvel going to come back on the front of a push truck.
He just lost power, that's all.
Take a look at some former winners here. Some great ones have driven here at Salem. Swikert and Sachs. There's AJ, a 2-time winner, and Parnelli Jones. Roger McCluskey, the director of competition for USAC, won in 1963. Mario a couple of times. And you talk about Poncho, looky there. 1974 through 1977, won 4 straight. He had this racetrack figured out.
And he was in that Steve Stapp car, the one that Jim Mahoney won our first heat race in tonight. He did a great car.
Did you see that 82 winner? Larry Rice on the dirt.
Never heard of him.
You never liked the high banks, did you? To be honest, you didn't like the high banks.
No, you're right. I didn't. I never was very fond, especially of the high banks.
Well, we talked about Tony Stewart making his debut run here. He's back in fifth position. We take a look back at second place as we go back to racing. There's that gap between first and second. A good start for Kuecker.
Jim Kuecker seems to have this racetrack figured out, has the race car working very, very well. He pulls out to a big lead. Chip Thomas, though, I think, is very happy with his race car. Even though he's not keeping up with Kuecker, this is the best he's ever run on the banks. I think he's got to be happy with himself and the race car.
2 laps to go, and we watch that battle again resume for that fourth and final transfer position. The block number 2, Randy Sweet, and there goes Tony Stewart. Oh, he wants that. He can taste it. He wants to make his first feature ever.
He's trying ever so hard. I just hope he doesn't try so hard that he makes a mistake.
Looks to the inside. He may have him now.
He's working hard. Boy, oh boy, is that kid working hard. He really is running that race car very, very well. He just cannot quite
There it goes for him. He's going to heat up that right rear, and he realizes he's out of it now as Kuecker takes the victory. I am impressed with young Tony Stewart.
I think he did a great job. Experience is going to teach him that 3 and 4 on this racetrack is not the place to run that low. But his first time out, I think he did a great job. I think he's got a lot to be proud of.
As we look at Jim Kuecker, who won this race, you have to believe right now that even though Tony's dad is disappointed, he's breathing a sigh of relief because he really didn't want his kid out here running the high banks this evening. Jim Kuecker takes the victory in the car that we spotlighted earlier, the one I called the legendary sprint car, built in 1978 by Glenn Nibel, as the bonfire continues to roar in the infield here in Salem as Kuecker, Thomas, Rose, and Sweet transfer the main event. A 30-lapper is coming your way next. Saturday Night Thunder is being brought to you by AutoZone, the right parts at the right price. By Choice Hotels International. By your local ERA real estate specialist.
Saturday Night Thunder coming to you live from Salem, Indiana, and a big crowd on hand tonight to enjoy the action here on the high banks. We're glad you're here to be part of the show. We got a little more news from elsewhere around the racing world to catch up with, and we're going to talk to our semifinal winner, Jim Kuecker. We'll start with the Busch Grand National activity this weekend. They're up in New Hampshire where Jimmy Hensley has the pole. Local guy Joey Carafa is going to start outside row 1. Kenny Wallace and Robert Presley share the second row. Davey Allison, first of the Winston Cup guys there in the qualifying activity for that race coming up. Quick look at last week's results from the USAC sprint cars. They were in Terre Haute for a very, very hot Jim Herdebees Classic. Hottest man of all was Jack Hewitt, who won it over Tony Elliott. Johnny Parsons got a call at 10 o'clock in the morning, said, "We got a ride for you, Johnny." 2 hours later, he was on the racetrack, and 2 hours after that, he was third in the feature. Frankie Kerr. And we move on to the World of Outlaws activity. That is Santa Fe Speedway in Hinsdale, Illinois. Take out the Kinzers and the Swindells, and Doug Wolfgang won the race. Steve Kinzer comes out on top again. win over Sammy, with Jeff finishing third. Earlier today, the race trucks were in action, preliminary to tomorrow's big action at Des Moines, and Steve Saline came out on top in the truck race over Mike Hughes, Ray Kong, Don Markham, and Andy McDermott. Going to be a big weekend for motorsports up in Des Moines, Iowa. Big night right here for Jim Kuecker, who comes out of the semifinal, wins it, and heads for the main event. What are you doing in the semifinal, man?
We were just being patient in the heat race. The guys in front of me were racing pretty hard, and I decided to watch instead of get in the middle of it.
That sounds like wisdom was the better part of valor, maybe, huh?
Well, hopefully we can do the same in the next race.
We heard about that car of yours, a very special machine built back in 1978. How do you feel about racing a car that old?
Real well. It's a nice car. I think I'd rather be in it than any of the other ones here tonight.
Pretty well shaken down. You know what it's going to do, don't you?
Yeah, Glenn knows the car pretty well. He's been running it for a lot of years, and we usually come to the racetrack and it's right on the money off the trailer, so that's pretty comforting.
You like this place?
Yeah, I do like this racetrack. We've always done real well here, and hopefully we'll be able to give you guys some good TV time with that camera.
Now, have you got a second car, then, a backup car here as well?
Yeah, we do have a new car. It's a Bob East car. It has a V6 in it as well, and we haven't got all the bugs shook out of it quite yet, but I'm sure we will.
Well, you're sure not hurting for race cars tonight. We wish you good luck in the main event. I know you want to get ready, so go get them, man.
Thanks a lot, Dave.
Jim Kuecker comes out of the semifinal tonight and is bound for the main event as we warm up for the 30-lapper that is going to definitely be exciting. Now, Utah, I said at the top of the show, if you needed one word to describe this place, that word would be wild. Well, some of the wildest action took place earlier this afternoon. The stock cars did battle here on the high banks, and Gare and Lair are going to tell you all about it. Guys?
Well, they call these the super stocks. They have a tremendous following here in southern Indiana, northern Kentucky, and hold your breath for 35 laps. Scott Whitehouse and that 61 car, the yellow car, grabbed the lead early on. They're going to run 35 laps here on these 32, 33 degree bank turns, and one of the early problems by number 26, Danny Cashin, is about to lose a tire. Watch this. In the fence.
I think he lost the tire after he hit the fence.
He just ripped the tire off of it. Now watch this. Number five, Chuck Barnes, ends up with a good finish, but he had to come from the back of the pack after he gets in trouble, loses control. Talk about some weight transfer. He had it going back, right, left. Now he gets tapped. There he goes.
Boy, going down that back straightaway and sideways like that's got to be a thrill, even in one of those race cars, because they're running pretty fast.
Yeah, Danny Sullivan, eat your heart out. So you won at Indianapolis after spinning. A good look at number 31, Wayne Edwards. He was in trouble early. And now going for the lead, here is Scotty Earle. He had them all covered in that white number four. Good battle back in traffic with some cosmetic surgery on these cars.
That's aerodynamics, Gary, aerodynamics.
White flag, one lap to go. There's a good battle for second position as Chuck Barnes trying to overhaul Wayne Edwards. Edwards stays up high, Barnes to the inside, and after spinning, looping 360, continues on. He takes second position, but nobody this afternoon was going to catch Scotty Earle, that white number four. Look at him slide through turn four.
Well, I tell you what, they were hard on tires. Those were pretty narrow tires. And they
in the movie Days of Thunder, said if you're loose, you're fast. Well, they were loose and they were fast there as we congratulate our winner, Scotty Earle, in an immaculate Monte Carlo. Or is that, that's not a Chevelle. That's an older model Chevelle.
I like that.
I'll tell you, that was quite a show this afternoon.
I'll tell you what, my heart was with Wayne Edwards. He was my pick to win that thing. I figured anybody who shows up with a lavender race car has got a whole lot of courage. And he's a broad sliding fool. I'll tell you what, that was fun to watch. They are threatening me, Gary, that they may go to the dreaded Speedrome videotape when we come back. I'm not sure if they're going to be that mean to you. We'll be back with more of Saturday Night Thunder. Stay with us. We're back at Salem Speedway in southern Indiana, enjoying the USAC Sprint Car Show, and we've got the main event, 30 laps, up and coming. Ought to be a good one based on what we've seen out of the qualifying heat races here tonight. I must tell you that every television producer, somewhere deep inside, there beats a cruel, cruel heart. And our producer, Terry Langner, has been threatening for weeks to show this videotape and publicly humiliate Gary Lee. This in response to Lee's incessant bragging about his ability in everything from dwarf car match race to Sport Renaults at Mid-Ohio. And so, Gare, this one's for you, buddy. I think it's self-explanatory. Roll the videotape and watch Gary in action at the Indianapolis Speedrome. He looks like a race driver. He really does. But Watch car four. Loses one spot. Jockeying for position. Looking inside, looking outside. Loses another spot. Headed for the back at flank speed. And says, I knew that camera should not have come tonight. Actually, Gary does reasonably well at the speedrome. Lee, sorry about that, but I only do what the producers give me here.
You know, what I can't understand is the abuse that I take. They weren't shooting Rice when he missed that big dirt car show at the state fairgrounds back in May in Indianapolis. I have a bad night, and the camera is there.
I didn't hear a thing about Larry missing that show.
You know, I've always said that if you can't laugh at yourself, you don't have a sense of humor, and you guys make me prove that every week.
In all fairness, Gary, that was one of your worst nights, no doubt.
Thank you. And now everybody, millions of viewers know that. I'm trying to find a sponsor, and you guys are showing that.
Well, Gary, we do appreciate that. You do certainly give yourself lots of opportunities for us to laugh at it. We're going to be back with the feature coming up here at Salem. Thanks to Gary Lee for being such a good sport. We'll have more right after this.
Salem, a humiliated Gary Lee along with Larry Rice and Dave Despain as we are getting ready for our 30 lap feature, and we are being seen by some additional race fans tonight, actually I should say this afternoon.
That's exactly right, in beautiful Auckland, New Zealand. It is 1 o'clock on Sunday afternoon and they're seeing us live. I think this is the second week now they've seen us live, and so we want to say hello to all of our friends in New Zealand. And next winter we're going to try to make a little trip down there. We're arranging a little group with Air New Zealand.
Can we go race?
Well, I certainly hope so. We're going to try to go down there anyway.
All right. Well, we welcome our viewers in New Zealand as we review once again the heat races. Heat race number one. These four transferred from that race. Jim Mahoney, Joey Saldana with a good performance by the youngster, four-time champion Steve Butler, and the veteran from Cincinnati, Greg Staub. In the second heat race, four more transferred. Chet Phillip, Bruce Roby, Bob Ciccone, and second the point standings, Eric Gordon. In the third heat race, once again, four transferred. An impressive ride by the youngster Rick Howerton. Robbie Stanley leads the point standings. He was second. Donnie Adams a third. And Bob Seelman rounding out the top four. In the fourth heat race, the winner was Gene Lee Gibson, debuting that new Loeffler-built sprint car. Brad Armstrong was second. Jeff Bloom third. And Jamie Matthews, who paints helmets as a sideline, finished fourth. And then in the semi-feature, it was Jim Keeker with the camera, Chip Thomas, Bill Rose, and Randy Sweet. So those four transferred. We have 20 cars ready to go 30 laps in the 32nd running of the Joe James Pat O'Connor Memorial. And Dave, you are standing by with certainly a very competitive driver.
Steve Butler is one of the guys that is in that battle for the point lead. Steve Butler, you got some traffic to deal with tonight. What are the chances here?
Well, Jim Keeker's up on the front row and Eric Gordon's up there, so they're real fast, and it's going to be tough. We're just going to try to, you know, keep up the first 10 laps or so. Then we're going to try to see if we can pass them. Hopefully we can. If not, you know, made the best man to win.
How's your confidence level right now?
Well, we made some changes on the car. We're not quite as confident in it as we normally are, but we did have quick time, so, you know, I think we got a shot.
Steve Butler, third in the points and ready to have at it tonight as he heads off to do battle with the guys up front. It's main event time here at Salem Speedway as they start pushing off the field for the 30 lapper for the sprint on the high bank. 40th running of a great race. We'll be right back to bring you the action.
From the Salem Speedway for the 32nd running. But coming up next week, we start to say the 32nd running of the Joe James Pat O'Connor race. Next week, it's the USAC Midget Series, the Hardy's Racing Series from Claremont, Indiana, 9 o'clock Eastern time. We have seen some excellent racing out there. You'll want to join us because we have, in addition to all the cage cams and the wall cams, we have a track cam we're going to mount in the track. Oh, that should be great.
That should be exciting.
We can see who's dropping oil than it drops on top of the camera lens.
The officials will want to see that camera all night long. long, believe me.
We want to say hi to Bob Fry. Bob Fry has been the driver of that number 20 car. As we take a look at Tony Stewart, the young man who made his debut here this evening, he will be the first alternate, but he'll strap up just in case there's a chance he can go out and run. Bob Fry watching from Wickenburg, Arizona this evening. Bob and his wife Judy involved in a new mortuary out there, so they're devoting all their attention to the business, and they had to take a sabbatical from racing. We know he's watching. We wish him well in his new business. Well, we take a look now at car number 85.
Yeah, he's having
Bruce Beal had some trouble earlier.
I think he's having trouble. I don't know whether they've looks to me like they're pushing that thing back in. So if they are in fact doing that, then Tony Stewart might in fact get to start his very first race on the banks and by running fifth in the semi, which is great news for him. Yeah, he's getting out of the car. Looks like Bruce Fields is getting out of the car. So if he wasn't in the race?
No, I don't think he was in the starting lineup. He had some trouble earlier, so I think they were working on that car perhaps. But Dave, I was very impressed with young Tony Stewart. Let's get some comments from the youngster.
I don't know how much Tony will have to say because he's an alternate here with a shot perhaps at making it. Are you aware that one of the guys hadn't fired up yet? You may have a chance to make your first sprint car feature here. How you feeling?
I'm praying for him not to start.
Are you nervous?
Yeah, I think I'm hoping I get to run just for the track time mainly. I want to get some laps.
Want to get some experience, some seat time. What do you think of your first sprint car race here? You really ran pretty well, I thought.
Well, when I got in some traffic and got racing with other cars, my confidence went up. You know, I just got to learn the limit of the car and the limit of myself right now. I'm running with some cars help.
Good luck, young man. We're going to get out of the way because I got a feeling he may try to fire this thing up momentarily. Tony Stewart, the alternate, may get a chance in his first ever sprint car race to run the main event tonight. Back up topside.
Larry, to underscore, it takes laps, experience, and he's getting the laps. He wanted laps here this evening in the feature to get some more experience on the high banks.
Well, we said that was his main goal, to run here, to stay out of trouble, to learn the racetrack, and I think he learned a lot, especially in that semi. He learned that you could not run real, real low down through 3 and 4. When you did, the race car did not stick as well as it did up top. It looks like all 20 cars are running, Gary, as we look out the window here and count the cars. I think they're all 20 running, so he probably is not going to get to start his first race, but I'm sure he's quite happy with what's happened here tonight.
Once again, with a USAC sprint car format, the first six, the fastest six in qualifying, if they transfer on three. Well, now USAC is down there talking to you. Let's go back to what may be going on here in the pit area. Tony is suited up. He's the first alternate, but as Larry, you said, all 20 cars are fired and running, so.
No. They were standing. That's what the official said. He's holding up his hands. They're all starters. You can't start. They're all on the racetrack. He said there's no sense pushing off. And that's what he was trying to tell young Tony Stewart.
Well, once again, the fastest six inverted. So inside the front row, Eric Gordon. Outside, Jimmy Kuecker in number 20. In the second row, we have Jeff Blum and Chip Thomas. The third row, with those tied for the quick qualifying times, Chet Phillip and Steve Butler. In row 4, on the inside, Robbie Stanley, who leads the point standings. Outside, the newcomer from Stock Car Racing, Randy Sweet. In the fifth row, on the inside, Jim Mahoney. Outside, Bob Ciccone. The sixth row will be shared by Rick Howerton, a winner of a heat race, alongside Gene Lee Gibson, another heat race winner. And the seventh row on the inside, Greg Staub. Outside, Bill Rose. Row 8 will find Donnie Adams and Bruce Roby. The ninth row will have Bob Seelman and Brad Armstrong. And in row 10, Jamie Matthews and Joey Saldana. So once again, it should be a great shootout from the front of the pack with your fastest qualifier starting in row 3. But it may be tough to catch Mr. Kuecker in that number 20 V6 Glenn Nibel car.
This is going to be a dynamite race, let me tell you, because there are at least 8 or 10 cars in here. And we say this every week, but it's true every week. There are 8 or 10 cars that could win this race, but Kuecker is going to be tough starting in the front row.
I think Jeff Blum might be a factor here. Jeff Blum is a pavement specialist. He starts inside the second row. Wally Scheer turns him loose, and we are racing at Salem, Indiana. And once again, from the in-car camera, we look back at Chip Thomas in the yellow and red number 24. He's in third position. Out in front is Kuecker. There in second is Eric Gordon.
That's right. Eric Gordon in that black number 6 moved right into second. Chip Thomas fell to third in that yellow number 24. And Jim Blum, in fact, is in fourth place in that blue number 67 car.
Oh, coming right here. 3, 4, 5 cars involved.
Oh, my gosh. Guys are they're still getting into
it. Well, we can see Mahoney down on the inside. There is Randy Sweet in the black number two, and there is the Leffler car, number nine of Gene Lee Gibson. Bill Rose in number three, another black car and a red car, and obviously we cannot discern the numbers from right here, so we won't try to guesstimate who's involved if we can't make out the number.
That's Ricky Howard, and is the other car up on the fence. We can't see him, but this is Jim Mahoney down here. It looks like, it looks like he might have got his bell rung. He might be in trouble there because he's not moving around too much. And Steve Stapp
is sitting there on the left rear tire.
Steve Stapp is sitting there trying to make sure he's okay. It looks like he's moving around. He's moving his left arm. I think he's okay, but he got hit real, real hard. That's Steve Stapp making sure. There's Sweet. There's Randy Sweet getting out of his car. That's Gene Lee Gibson in the 9 car. He's moving around. He's all right.
There we see the Bill Rose, the tail of Bill Rose's car, and he is out.
That's Bob Ciccone.
Bob Ciccone in the red 59. He is still in the cockpit, and you can just see the tail at the top of your screen of number 6. And you said that, yeah, that's Rick Howerton because he has the red, white, and blue driving suit. All the drivers are out or at least moving around inside the cockpit and still talking to Gene Lee Gibson there.
Yeah, it looks like all these guys up on the top of the racetrack, they're all moving around. They all seem to be getting out of their race cars, seem to be all right. I think Mahoney is all right. He was moving around also, but he wasn't getting out of the car quite as quickly as did the guys up here on top of the racetrack.
Larry Rice, we have made this point before. These guys are so fast on the high banks here at Winchester. If something happens in front, the guy really behind does not have time to make some evasive move.
The closing speed is so unbelievably fast that when something happens, you have no chance. They're waving the red flag now, Gary. They're going to stop everybody. It's awfully congested down there. The whole track is almost blocked. It was kind of dangerous for the safety player or safety people to try to work around there while those cars were running through there.
Well, as the red flag is being displayed, perhaps on a replay, we can discern what happened that got this thing triggered. Now, I think it's perhaps on pass to the lower right of your screen. There's Ciccone in the red number 9. Ciccone, there's contact right in front of Ciccone.
It looked like there was contact up there. That looks like Jim Mahoney up against the fence up at the top. That was Randy Sweet, and he got together. Everybody else just kind of were trying to miss the crash, running into each other. They didn't hit too hard. Mahoney's the one that backed into the fence up on the top. Here's Billy Rose. He hit the fence way back up there and didn't have any brakes. And then he came along and bammed into Gene Lee Gibson. But he hit the fence back up the track and lost his brakes. That's the reason he was still running in there at that point.
One of the drivers involved, Rick Howerton, is standing by with Dave Despain.
First man out and walking away is Rick Howerton. Rick, what happened up there?
Someone tried passing a bunch of guys, tried to get underneath the bottom of Bob Ciccone down bottom and just pushed all the way up on the side of him, and then other people just got gathered up.
You had no place to go then? Where were you in the fray?
Right to the side of Bob.
So you basically just were stuck in the middle. Rick Howerton is okay. We'll have an update on everybody else. Preliminary indication is all the drivers are okay. We'll be back with more from Salem Speedway right after this timeout. Stay with us for more of Saturday Night Thunder. We're trackside at Salem Speedway, where a 5-car pileup has stopped the main event here. The update on Bill Rose, Rick Howerton, Bob Ciccone, and Gene Lee Gibson, A-OK. Meanwhile, Jim Mahoney has been taken to the infield, and they're going to check him out in the ambulance. The preliminary indication, no serious injury. Gene Lee Gibson, been checked out, I guess, and pronounced OK. How you feeling?
Got a headache.
Took a lick there, didn't you?
But whoever hit me, he hit me good. I was up and the wreck in front of me, and I'd spun it and was sitting there, and I thought it was all over with, and then kaboom.
It's true, huh?
Yeah, something. But hell, one of them deals.
It's a bad way for a wrap up of a new race. Good to see you're okay.
Yeah, we'll come back next time.
Gene Lee Gibson says he's okay, and we'll have an update on Jim Mahoney as soon as it's available.
Well, obviously, we saw exactly what happened as far as Gene Lee getting tagged after he thought the race was over. And perhaps we can take a look. There's perhaps some damage there on the fence outside the entrance to turn one. Mahoney took a couple of good shots as he wrapped the fence pretty hard. He got together with Randy Sweet. Once again, the white car on the outside right here, the black number 2 car, and they get together just to the right of your screen right here. And that will turn Mahoney around, and Mahoney will hit the wall right here going into turn one.
Yeah, it was just some misjudgment there somehow. They got into together. Look at Mahoney when he hits that fence. Boy, he hit that fence hard, and that's the reason he got hurt. Everybody else back here, Gene Lee Gibson, he's sideways. Everybody's trying to miss it. But we see Bill Rose up here in the right-hand corner. He's hit the fence and knocked the brakes out of his car. Here we see the
top of the screen, right there. The white number four, the black number two get together.
I think that what happened was Mahoney's tried to move up the racetrack a little bit, and he didn't see Sweet up there. Sweet didn't give him enough room, and boy, when they touched at this speed, everything's going to happen all at once.
Now watch exactly Mahoney hit the wall.
Here he comes up. Bang. Look at his head. Clear outside that cage.
That will stretch the neck out, and he'll be a sore pup tomorrow. He'll have one sore neck.
That's what hurt him. When he hit that wall that hard, you're really traveling fast. And look at this. Everybody's up on two wheels or banging around, and nobody got upside down. They were very, very fortunate that that didn't happen.
Well, we have one lap complete of a 30-lap feature. This is the Joe James Pat O'Connor Memorial. Pat O'Connor lived not too far from here in North Vernon, Indiana, and I don't think there was ever, Larry Rice, a more popular driver from the state of Indiana to strap on a race car than Pat O'Connor.
I never met Pat O'Connor, but I've met his son, and believe me, everyone I've talked to that knew him had nothing but high praise for Pat O'Connor. He's a good-looking young guy, had a great way with the people, and when he was gone in racing, it was a big loss for everybody, believe me.
Well, the cleanup continues down here in turn one of the Joe James Pat O'Connor Memorial Race at the Salem Speedway in southern Indiana on Saturday Night Thunder. We come to you live, we'll clean up the debris, and we'll come back and resume racing. As the cleanup continues, they work on Bob Ciccone's car. We remind you to join us for Speed Week every Saturday at 7:30 Eastern Time here on ESPN. Bob Jenkins and the crew with all the motorsports news. And the crew continues to work on Bob Ciccone's number 59. He was involved up there, only tapped slightly, so that's his dad off the right rear. That is Lou Ciccone, his brother also working on the car. Danny Dwynan is there, the car that he built. So perhaps we'll see the veteran from Prospect Park. But those involved in that crash at the end of lap one, Rick Howerton, we've talked to Rick, Bob Ciccone there in the cockpit, Bill Rose, Gene Lee Gibson, Randy Sweet, and Jim Mahoney. And of course, we talked about how far out the neck was stretched. There's a look at Anna walking with her boyfriend, Gene Lee Gibson. Good-looking driving suit, the Alan Knott car out of competition this evening. Obviously, when it's a fast racetrack like this, they gather them up. There's no place to go.
It's a tough break for him. I don't think any of those cars are going to be able to restart, except maybe Bob Ciccone. And they're working real hard on that car. He was probably the least involved. Everybody else that got touched up there got touched pretty doggone hard, and I think they'll be out for the remainder of the evening.
Well, they're still working up there. There's one car still as we watch again. There's Danny Dwynan, the Yellow Earls T-shirt. He's working on the car that he built for Bob Ciccone. And we look up in the turn, though, and there's still one car up there that's being worked on.
They moved the engine back in this car, and Bob says he likes it a lot better. The suspension on that car is kind of different, and so they had to change some things. It's pretty new. Here we see Rick Howerton's car. The front end's all bent up on it. You can see that it's probably not going to be able to be fixed, and they're going to haul it into the pits now. They just don't have enough wreckers to get them all off of there that quickly. When you've got five or six cars all disabled on the racetrack, it takes a while to get everything gathered up and off the racetrack. That's all.
We talked about Speed Week. We certainly hope that you saw our interview with Tommy Kendall on Speed Week, as he has high hopes of leaving the Methodist Hospital this week, returning to his home in California. And obviously, it's going to be a long convalescent, but we wish him well. He is watching this evening from Methodist Hospital in Indianapolis. In fact, he had the entire ESPN Motorsports schedule memorized when I visited with him, and he knew exactly what he'd be watching all weekend. Well, we look again at the Loeffler-built car. Bob Ciccone is out of his car. No, he's still in the car, but he'll have a chance to talk to Dave Despain with his helmet on.
And let's see what Bob has to say about getting back on the horse that threw him here. First of all, you were pretty lucky out there.
Well, can you hear me okay, Dave?
I think so, Bob. Fire away.
I saw that the situation occurring, and that's why I was about a car length or two. I suspected something like that was going to unfold, and I was right. Mahoney got in a little too hot, and I think he didn't have enough control, got up into Randy Sweet, and even though I saw it happening and I anticipated it, they shut the whole track off for me, so I had to throw it sideways and try to lock it up. And another car, about a half hour later, got me in the left rear there. So everything seems to be intact in the race car, so we're going to give it another try. This time we have to start all the way in the back, though.
You're not concerned about going back out there in a car that took a lick like that. You're confident.
That's not a lick. That's just like a little, like a love tap. You know what I mean? So everything that has to be correct is okay. They check the suspension components, and that they're all okay, and we should be in good shape.
Okay, man, go get him. That's Bob Saccone. He says, hey, I got no problem with this car. Let me at him. Only problem I got is I got to start in the back.
It's like kissing your sister. It's not that serious, right?
Yeah, I'll tell you what, he made a very good point right there. He said, even though I saw it happening, I anticipated it, I knew exactly what was going on, I got out of the throttle, and I still closed on the accident so quickly that I got in the middle of it, and then people ran into me. That's exactly the way things happen here. You can see them happening, but at 130 or 40 miles an hour that you're running at the end of that straightaway, you cannot stop the car or turn the car or get out of the way quick enough to mix an accident like that. That's the reason everybody gets involved.
There's a look from Robbie Stanley's car. We talk about how articulate Bob Saccone is. So many folks have talked to us about the interview he did with Dave after that big crash at Winchester. He could still laugh. He could still smile. And let's go back to Dave Despain with an update on Jim Mahoney.
Saccone, by the way, is one of my heroes for that particular interview. Jim Mahoney is out of the ambulance. They've checked him over, and it appears that the worst he has suffered is a bruised rib. He's pretty sore. We may get a chance to get a word with him, but the good news is that Jim Mahoney is indeed okay. So five guys got involved up there, and the cleanup continues. They tore up an awful lot of race cars, but the drivers are okay. We'll be back with more of the restart coming up here on this 30 Lapper. Stay with us.
Saturday Night Thunder live from Salem, Indiana for the USAC Loctite Sprint Car Series on the high banks of Salem, the Joe James Pat O'Connor Memorial, the 32nd running of this prestigious event. We are still under red, but as you can see, the cars now are being pushed away. Some upcoming events here at Salem, August 7th, the Midweek Madness. A lot of following for the late models and the mini stocks down here in southern Indiana. And also August the 11th, the USAC Sprints and the local stock cars will go at it once again here at Salem. So we have one lap complete as we take a look at the man who leads the point standings. That is Robbie Stanley. He has won twice this season. As we go in-car camera, the CarQuest in-car cage cam, we look over the top of the car down the backstretch. He has won twice this year on the high banks at Winchester. As you said earlier, Larry, he hadn't seen Winchester before he won.
He hasn't seen this place, and I think he's got a great chance to win here. These in-car shots are pretty incredible that these guys give us from the camera crew, because it gives you an idea of how banked, how close, how much these race cars move around on this racetrack. And they do move around a lot. And when you're following another driver and he's moving the race car around, you don't know exactly what to do. And it gives you a good idea of what that driver has to anticipate and look at when he's back there.
And once again, coming up next week from Indianapolis Raceway Park with the USAC Sprint Cars, we're going to have a track cam mounted in the track to see the cars actually run overhead. That should be interesting.
That should be
wild. Who's coming up with all these camera ideas?
I don't know, but I'll tell you, it should be wild to see those guys run over there.
The lighting here, we first thought, how can you run at night at Winchester or Salem? You're going that fast. The lights are not sufficient. We have lights here that are incredibly bright. Is that disconcerting for a driver?
No, you don't even notice those lights. Even though they look like they might glare on you from our camera angle, you're so focused on what you're doing in that race car that something like the lighting, it doesn't even pay attention. It could be two-thirds darker than this. A lot of times you race on racetracks that are very, very dark, but you don't notice it. You're so focused on doing what you're doing. It's just like getting tired or being hurt or having a sore muscle or whatever. You're so focused on everything else that you don't have time to worry about those sort of things.
Robbie Stanley, by virtue of his strong showings on the pavement this season with a 42 mark lead over Eric Gordon. And it's incredible because he has a wealth of experience on dirt. He's had a terrible time on dirt. He's winning everything on the paved tracks.
Yes, he is. And he's... Dave, you got a question for us up here?
Yeah, Larry, I'd like to ask you more about that whole business of visibility. Give me an idea what you're using for your landmarks on the racetrack. Where are you actually looking? Where are the driver's eyes focused?
Okay, as you're looking down into this corner here, first of all, you don't get that wide a picture. Those slots in those helmets are much narrower than this, so you're only seeing about the top of that cage down to the track. That's all you're seeing in front of you, and you're looking off to the left as far as that camera can see right there. Now you look clear down the racetrack, clear into that next corner.
and the cars are in front of you, but as you go through here, you're actually looking off out of camera range right here. You're looking farther down the racetrack, and if you're not looking off farther down the racetrack and something happens, you're in big trouble. So you don't get a clear view of what the driver's seeing, because the driver has to watch much farther around the corner going through there than the camera shows.
Larry, obviously a driver gets the adrenaline flowing on the warm-up lap, the pace lap, the green flag falls, and we're racing. Okay, now we have a red flag. How long does it take to get pumped back up into a rhythm for the restart?
I think most of these guys are already pumped back up. They don't need to be repumped. If anything, they get too pumped up sitting there. The anticipation of sitting there and waiting makes them more pumped up than they were before. Here we see Bob Saccone again, and he's running again. I think he's smart enough to test that race car out for a lap or two, and if it's running good, you'll see him moving towards the front.
Well, of course, he has great confidence in the crew that was looking over that car that said it was okay. What changes can these guys make to the car during a red?
Well, they can do just about anything they want to. Most of the drivers out there didn't have a very good chance to really find out what the race car was doing. Saccone, in his case, he went through and just checked to make sure everything was tight, nothing was broken, nothing was bent. That was his main concern. The rest of these drivers, they might have found some small changes, but most of them didn't have really a lot of time to find out what the big problems were going to be with their cars.
Well, here is your leader, and he will set the pace for the restart. That is Jim Kuecker in that V6 Chevrolet, the Parker Machinery car that was built 1978 by Glenn Nibel. We featured that car earlier this evening here on ESPN. Right behind him, Eric Gordon in that black number 6. He is second in the point standings currently. Chip Thomas surprised a lot of folks with a good qualifying run as we look once again at Eric in second. And then Chip Thomas rides in the third position in at car number 24. And then third, make that fourth, is the pavement master, and that is Jeff Bloom out of the state of Michigan. Once again, he could be a factor here before this race is over. And then riding in the fifth position, of course, the four-time USAC sprint car champion, Steve Butler. We are about to go green. Oh, there was some tapping out there. Butler got tapped from the rear, and Wally Scheer turns them loose. This will be lap number 2 at Salem. And once again, Kuecker is out in front. Eric Gordon rides in second.
Yeah, Chip Thomas in third position in that yellow car. And in fourth position is Jeff Bloom. And looks like Steve Butler's already got notions about going around him.
And now we ride with Robbie Stanley. And that is in the sixth position. He rides behind Steve Butler. Butler out in front in that white and red number 69. And right in front of Butler is that blue number 67 of Jeff Bloom.
Stanley's really trying hard to catch these guys. I thought he'd pick up on these guys a little quicker than he has. But he seems to be having a little trouble catching up with Gordon and Bloom right there in front of him. But he's running that race car for all it's worth. And he's going to hunt around. He's going to try to find a little different place on the racetrack where he can run faster.
Well, you see, talk about spring rage. You saw the car bottom out there. That was Butler. And there's Saccone from the back of the pack. He goes by Roby, and he's picked off about 5 cars so far on the restart.
They must have fixed that thing pretty doggone good, because he's moving pretty quick through the pack and already up there.
He's up to 9th place already. Bob Saccone, the veteran from Prospect Park. We have to thank his dad, Lou, for those Philadelphia hoagies he gave us earlier. I don't know if I can make it through the entire race.
They fly those in every week, and they were good. I have to agree with that.
So Saccone on the roll in 9th position.
Look at Kuecker. He's running a fantastic race, but it looks like Butler is trying to make the big pass right here. He's going to get around him right there. Once he got up even with him and got a good shot coming off the corner, he was gone. Chet Phillip and Robbie Stanley now catching up with Bloom, and they're both going to try to give him a shot.
Well, we said earlier that Robbie was going to watch Steve Butler and learn from the master here at Salem, and perhaps he could learn how to make that pass of Bloom. They work off the second corner down the backstretch.
Right there, you saw that Stanley had to get out of the throttle and fall in behind him, because a slower car, he couldn't run in there 3 abreast. He had to fall in behind him going into that corner.
Your leader going through traffic as the lapping process has begun down the backstretch. There's the gap off to the left, the yellow number 20. That's the V6 Chevrolet being driven by Jim Kuecker. There's the gap back to second position, the black number 6, the Molds Unlimited Oscar, and that is Eric Gordon. And there is the battle now for third spot. Chip Thomas in 24 is third. Up to fourth is Steve Butler. And fifth now is Robbie Stanley.
Yes, Robbie Stanley's on the move. He's moved up fifth, and he started a long way back. Butler also is doing a fantastic job. He's working very hard on Chip Thomas. He's going to school right now. He's trying to find the spot, and it looks like he's found the spot. He thinks he can make it. No, he has to fall back. And all the time he's doing this, Stanley's sitting back there behind him and paying attention.
He's learning. He's going to see what Butler does, and then he's going to try to make the same kind of move.
Well, Butler, of course, now third in the point standings. We are riding with the guy who leads the point standings by virtue of his superb showing on paved tracks this season. He's won twice in the high banks of Winchester. I'm speaking, of course, of the youngster from Brownsburg, Indiana, Robbie Stanley. There's a move for position up to third, and that's Butler.
He saw that Chip Thomas was getting a little bit loose. He saw him. He's getting a little bit loose every time he got in the corner. He finally dove down under him and just motored on by coming off.
So Butler goes to third, and he will set sail for Eric Gordon, and there is a good battle for the fourth position.
Boy, that was close.
It's still close. Jeff Bloom has dropped out of the race. Jeff Bloom is behind the pit wall. They go by Bob Seelman on the high side. And now Robbie looks to the inside, coming off two. He should have him this time, yes. And here comes Chet Phillip.
Chet Phillip tried to follow him right on by, but couldn't quite do it. When Stanley got around and he slid up in front of Chip Thomas had to get out of the throttle or they were to touch. He did a good job there because Robbie didn't give him very much room.
Well, Stanley now begins to close in on third position. We have a yellow flag. A yellow flag, a car has stopped there. We just saw a glimpse of a car parked on the high side entering turn three. That is car 65, Bruce Roby. The car may have just jumped out of gear. Mechanically, it came to a stop. I don't think there was contact. There was contact with the wall. All right, we're being informed there was some contact with the wall, but obviously he is okay in the cockpit, and that brings out the yellow.
Yeah, it doesn't look like he hit the wall too hard. He probably hit it straight broadside. Going into three, where he's sitting, you go in and you go right up to the fence, right in the middle of the corner, and he probably just got in a little too hard, went up, banged the fence, and banged back off and stopped the car.
That's the Clarence Miller car that we've talked about a lot about being so old. About 15 laps now and complete, so we still have half the race to go. We are under yellow in the 32nd running of the Joe James Pat O'Connor Memorial Race here at Salem, with Kuecker leading Gordon, Butler, Stanley, and Thomas. Will come back and complete this race.
Saturday Night Thunder has been brought to you by Quaker State. The big Q is one tough motor oil. By Dunlop Tires. Dunlop outperforms. And by Bud Light. Everything else is just a light. In-car cameras provided by CarQuest Auto Parts. For your nearest CarQuest Auto Parts store, dial 1-800-492-PART. You'll find it at CarQuest.
Jeff Bloom is a spectator on Saturday Night Thunder tonight, a former winner. He won the Holman Classic on Saturday Night Thunder last year. Jeff, what finally put you out?
Well, we had engine trouble all night long. We've been running on seven cylinders, and it just started vibrating real bad. And you know, instead of taking a chance blowing a motor and, you know, hurting somebody else on a racetrack, we just, time to park it, you know, time to watch.
You'd have been hitting on all eight. You might have been running up front tonight, huh?
Well, we had fourth quick time on seven cylinders. I mean, the car was handling good. It just wouldn't run down a straightaway. So, you know, that's the way it goes.
We got one lap to green. Jeff Bloom is out of it. We're just about ready to get going again here, guys.
Once again, the reason for the yellow is Jim Kuecker leads under yellow. Was Bruce Roby made some contact with the wall going into turn three, and he parked the Clarence Miller car up there on the track. So we're under yellow with 15 of 30 laps complete here at Salem, Indiana. Once again, next week we'll be at Indianapolis Raceway Park for the USAC Midgets, as the car is being towed off the racetrack, and we should get, at least another lap, Larry Rice, under yellow before we turn them loose. And Kuecker out in front in the car that we featured earlier, the Glenn Nibel built car, the teenager that's won probably more races than all these cars in this feature combined.
Yes, it has. That's a very good race car, very good operation that Glenn Nibel has with that race car, too. He's put more than one driver in that same car in one race. It wasn't just Bob Fry and Glenn Nibel. It's been Jim Kuecker and it's been other guys. So it's a good operation they have, a good race car, and just a good combination all the way around, to be honest with you.
Our report from USAC is that we have some antifreeze on the track, which will extend the yellow. That would make it very slick down there in the third turn.
Very, very slick. Believe me, there is Joey Saldana, our good friend of mine, lives right down the road. First time on the pavement that he's really had a good showing, and I know he and his father are very, very happy. He's running ninth right now. This car is a J&J car. It's just like the one that Robbie Stanley has, so they know the race car is good. I think the big thing is getting Joey to feel comfortable, and obviously he feels much more comfortable tonight than he has in the past.
You race with his dad, Joe, and it's got to be tough to be a second-generation driver. Your dad was successful. People expect you to be successful. Your kid, Robbie, is racing now, and that's got to be tough.
Well, it is tough on them. You know, they have a lot to live up to, but most of these guys historically have come up and been pretty doggone good race car drivers, just like the Jones boys on the West Coast and all the rest of them. They've done well.
We ride with Robbie Stanley, who rides in fourth position. Who do you like now in this one?
Well, it looks like Keeker is going to be awfully, awfully tough to beat. I think if Steve Butler gets around here, why, he might have a shot at him. I think he's the only one that has a true shot at getting him right now.
Well, we continue under yellow because we do have the antifreeze in the track. They're going to put some oil dry down to soak that up and make the track raceable here in Salem, Indiana. So we'll take this break, and we'll come back with the final 15 laps on Saturday Night Thunder. Live coverage of USAC Sprint Car Racing from Salem. There's a look at a combination of oil, antifreeze, and oil dry down in the third corner. Don't forget, coming up next, baseball tonight. John Saunders will have all the information for you. Scores and highlights immediately following our Joe James Pat O'Connor feature, and we are about to go green. We have 15 laps down, 15 laps to go as Jimmy Keeker picks up the throttle. And as we take a ride with Robbie Stanley, there is the green flag from starter Wally Shear, and we are racing on lap number 16.
This is a fantastic shot. Look at these guys moving in and out, trying to find a way around the driver in front of them. You know, Stanley's back here. He's trying to watch the driver in front of him and figure out a way to get around him, but it's very, very tough to do. Very, very fast. Those guys are running about 140, 145 miles an hour at the end of that straightaway. Tough to make quick decisions and make the right ones at that speed.
Well, Keeker looks like he's getting some pressure right now from young Eric Gordon. Eric finished second both in the sprints and the Silver Crown standings last year. He rides second right now in the point standings.
You know, it might be that the yellow flag cooled off Eric Gordon's tire, but if he keeps running down there and slipping the rear end like he did right there, he'll heat it up again, and it'll give Steve Butler the opportunity to go around him. He needs to cool it a little bit, try to make a move, but not make too many false ones on the bottom.
Well, Keeker continues to lead with Gordon second. Third is Butler, and they're taking a look to the inside. We are riding with Robbie Stanley, who presently leads the point standings by some 42 markers over Eric. So once again, the top three in points are in the top four positions right now, with first place riding in fourth. Second place is second. Oh, look at him smoke that right rear. And third place is third.
And they're driving the wheels off those race cars right now. Believe me, they're all working the very hardest they possibly can to try to find a spot to get around the driver in front of them. But every one of them is going so fast, it's hard to gain that advantage.
There goes right there on the high side. Oh, and Gordon slipped up in front of him. But Gordon is working low again. Oh, he's sliding across the front. He is going in way too low. That's not the groove down there.
Well, it should be, but he hit that oil dry and all that liquid down there, and he really slid up in front of him. Look at Butler. He goes way high, trying to get a big, long run down a straightaway, but he just can't gain enough momentum or enough speed down a straightaway to get around him. It looks like Keeker is getting loose, though. Keeker in that yellow car is getting awfully, awfully loose, much looser than he was earlier. Look at it, loose! Oh, man!
All four of them right together, a new leader. Oh. Eric Gordon takes the lead. Here comes Butler, and now he's still sliding. He is dirt tracking through the corner.
He's on the tire. The left rear tire just blew on that thing right in front of Stanley. Right as they came by, there's a left rear tire.
He's trying to control it down the front straightaway. You're right, Larry, and he will make it off the track, so the green remains out. Oh, a heartbreaker for Jimmy Keeker, who had been leading, but the lead now belongs to Eric Gordon. We are going to have a shootout over the final few laps here in Salem.
Boy, those guys did a fantastic job missing him. That tire was going down for three or four laps. It kept getting looser and looser and looser, and finally it just blew up, and Robbie Stanley was right behind him. Boy, how he missed him, I'll never know.
Five laps to go. I think we're completing lap number 25. Five laps to go, and here comes the battle for the lead.
There he went. Oh, boy, was that close. He went right around him, and Eric Gordon tries to go back in it, but he couldn't do it. He tried to get back under him.
As close as they're running, I tell you, they may take each other out, and we may have the winner coming from the third spot right now. Into traffic.
Oh,
look at that. That's Ciccone.
That was so close.
Oh, hang on. Oh, he was loose. You could feel that from up here. We're not even the cockpit. He was real loose coming off the second corner.
He was so close that I've never seen anybody run that close to the inside fence coming off of two here. That's extreme.
That race successfully come off.
That racetrack is dead flat down there where he was at. I don't know how he did it.
Well, now that he has the lead with three laps to go, Butler, the four-time champion, going for his fifth USAC sprint car title, begins to open up the gap. He may have conserved his right rear tire the best of all of them.
Exactly, and Eric Gordon has heated up his right rear. He's very loose at this point. He doesn't have a prayer of catching Butler at this point. He's going to hang on and hope he can finish in second place.
There's the white flag, one lap to go for Kokomo, Indiana's Steve Butler. And Butler, who had terrible luck early this season with mechanical problem, is beginning to put it all together through the midsection of the season, and he is certainly making a run toward his fifth national title. He will take the checkered flag, dual checkered flags. Wally Shear, Eric Gordon will hang on for second. Third is Robbie Stanley.
And Chip Phillip was fourth. He did a great job coming up through there. We didn't see him much, but he was driving the wheels off of that race car, too.
Boy, we just did get this race in.
Well, I tell you,
the time allotted.
These guys were driving their hearts out. Look right here. Stanley's trying to get underneath Kuechker. He's loose up there, and just as he gets right up to him, the left rear blows. Look at that thing. Oh, man, he was so lucky to miss him. It's unbelievable. Oh, there it goes. It just kept getting flatter and flatter. How he missed him, you know, because he's clear down. He's almost to the inside fence right there again, trying to get around him. Great.
Well, the crowd with some positive reaction for both the driving of Jim Kuechker and also for Steve Butler. Dave DeSpain, your comments.
One word, spectacular. I'll tell you what, man, that was some kind of an automobile race. At the top of the show, we said, keep an eye on Steve Butler. He's coming on hard. He really came on tonight to win this thing in a spectacular fashion as the shredded tire sent Kuechker to the sideline, and you saw the onboard shot. It was truly a magnificent night here at Salem Speedway. The results show Bob Ciccone coming from the back to finish sixth. There's the rest of the top ten. For Gary Lee and Larry Rice, we say so long with a big congratulations to Steve Butler. See you next week.